candy too. Hard knock, off in any loop, off the scoop. Play with me, see what the screamy do. My canary shoot, hot beams pointed right at you. Peekaboo, Benji paper made me hate a poo. All your family dupes, Najee twice, purple haze and goops. Got me loops, kick my way and now I got the juice. Gucci bubble boots, thousand kicks, couple.
What's good, what's good, what up, what up, what up? What's good? Thunder up. You already know what it is. Got my guy Ryan Hollins coming through. NBA vet. Sports reporter, analyst, all the above. Got him coming through. What up, Marcus? I see you, bro. Hey, we're going to chop it up, too. There you go right there. What's going on, Ryan? What's up? Let's get you in here.
What's good, bro?
What's going on? How's everything?
Man, day by day, bro.
Day by day. I know you're a busy man. I appreciate you for taking some time out for me.
Nah, absolutely, man.
I appreciate that. Yeah, man, it's crazy, man, because, you know, with all the news that we getting today, you know, I felt like it's perfect timing.
Man, there's a lot, man. I'm trying to, I think, make sense of it all from the civil unrest to the NBA going back and NFL players popping off, owners and coaches, cats are getting called out. This is like the Me Too movement of racism, dog. Like, yeah, I'm laughing up a little bit. It's like, man, golly.
Yeah. Nah, it's definitely crazy right now. But, you know, at the end of the day, we just got to get through this. You know what I'm saying? We always get through it. We always push. You know, as minorities, we always push to get through. You know what I'm saying? So, we definitely just got to continue to unite. You know, unity is key. You know what I'm saying?
I think it feels different, though, in the sense that, correct me if I'm wrong, I feel like we were raised to say, all right, you ain't grow up in the racism of segregation and getting beat and lynched and slavery, so we don't want to hear about that from y'all.
Yeah.
We don't want to hear about y'all calling a teacher or somebody racist. We don't want to hear that from y'all. Y'all just deal with it.
Yeah.
All right? And just know that you're not going to be treated equal. Just deal with it. And now it's like, nah, we not dealing with it no more.
Yeah, yeah. We fed up. We fed up with it. That's what it is. You know what I'm saying? And I mean, enough is enough. You know what I'm saying? Like, I posted some sneakers of KD when I first came out to OKC and covered them. And he had a KD6 with the Black Lives Matter on it for Eric Garner. So it's like, we still fighting. It's still the same thing. You know what I'm saying? So we still going through it. And, you know, it's going to take some time, but the thing is, we got to be active now. You know what I'm saying? Y'all wasn't listening when we were silent. Now, all of a sudden, y'all complaining. We riding and looting and doing all this stuff. So now we got to make the action speak louder than the words now, you know? So if you got to do that to make people reel back and be like, you know what? We got to join what they're doing and appreciate what they stand for. I'm all for it.
And I appreciate, you know, you work in the media also.
Mm-hmm.
We get so nervous to say something, you might get fired.
Yeah, yeah.
And then right after the show, you be like, yeah, you know that was some nonsense. So like, you know,
yeah.
If that was a brother, nigga, he would have been fired.
Yeah.
Then we just talk afterwards, but like, you go on air, you know, like, you know, you tread very lightly, you know. And
definitely.
And, or you just don't want to be, you don't want to be the guy stirring the pot, you know.
Yeah, you don't want to. Yeah. I definitely, even in Oklahoma City, I'm in Oklahoma City now, and, you know, even here, it's like, sometimes I tread lightly, you know what I'm saying, because I don't want to say the wrong thing, ruffle feathers or something like that, you know what I'm saying? I just try to continue to just stay in my lane, do what I do, report about the game and off the court when they, you know, rock something or something like that, and I just try to keep it simple and do what I do, my 1-2, and then go home and take care of my family. That's it.
Absolutely, man. And that's important, too, because, like, people don't realize, like, oh, man, protest, march, but, like, bro, I'm going to lose my job. Like, you got a family at home that you have to go and take care of. So, that, man, that's a really tough place to be in. Like, oh, man, you should have been riding. You should have been doing that. Like,
yeah.
Like, dude, like, that's something you don't, like, Kaepernick. Like, I do respect, maybe people could say it wasn't his Super Bowl year, or it was the best year when he did it. But regardless, man, you're sacrificing the way you feed your family.
Definitely.
If you ever been an athlete or in any job, you lose your job or you're no longer there, that's a scary place to be in where you don't know where the next check is coming from.
Definitely. And I was riding with the Kaepernick wave from day one. I knew what he was talking about. A lot of people took it the wrong way. You know what I'm saying? They felt like he was trying to go against the military and everything like that. I knew what he was talking about because we live, you know, we lived that. You know what I'm saying? What's good, Lance? I see you, bro.
What's good, Lance?
Yes, sir. And you know, we lived through that. You know what I'm saying? That's how we were raised, and at the end of the day, we always jump over those hurdles and those obstacles to get to where we need to get, regardless. So for him actually standing up for us and taking that pay cut and all that, he was like, I'm here for the long haul. Now look at you fast forward now, and everybody understands what we were talking about. So it is what it is.
But my stance with Cap was always, he's not wrong. He didn't say anything wrong at all. I don't know how he's, you know, villainized. He should be playing in the NFL. He's more than talented enough. Or don't lie to me and say that he's not playing because of that. But I understood the climate of the NFL in that whatever team he went to was going to be a media circus. It was going to be a movement. And I do understand that, but it still saddens me. It was just more so you accept what he's in. But I understood why the New England Patriots didn't want to bring him in, because it would be more about Colin Kaepernick than them going out and winning a Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And you don't want to ever be that distraction. But
I wanted him to join my Patriots, though. I wanted him to, because I feel like we're the team that would do it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So
I thought
we could, you know? We can use him right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, shoot, even like, you know, I thought Seattle would have been the perfect market, you know? And I'm confused what went on there. Some people said, I was told by a player that they just do that to let's seem acceptable. Yeah. Even though they was never really going to sign, like, we'll seem like we're the, because they always got they got that image from the Super Bowl days that, you know, we got all the misfits.
Yep.
And, you know, be careful.
It's a marketing ploy. It's a marketing ploy.
And turned them around.
it's a marketing ploy. You know what I'm saying? It's all about how you got to be strategic. You know what I'm saying? Because even he was strategic with his workout. He was like, you know what I'm saying? We keeping it 100 on here. He was like, look, at the end of the day, y'all ain't going to let me do what I want to do, so I'm just going to waste y'all time, too. Y'all come see me where I'm at. He changed the location on him. He said, I'm going to do it my way. So,
well, I understood the care, the nervousness, too, of if he works out and has a great workout, and the NFL puts out the notion that he wasn't in shape, he wasn't physically prepared to play.
Yeah.
You know, he's full of it. They could have ended what he had to do and for all.
Yep, that's true.
That was a sensitive place to be in, because he had never stopped working out. He may still be training, you know, ultimately. So, you know, that would have been a completely different message. But, you know, when you go and, like, sign Jay Cutler out of broadcasting and stuff like that. Come on, man. Like it just
my man Cap can't get no love.
Yeah. When you got down to the 135th quarterback available, that's when you got the dude off the couch. That's what we said. All right, y'all. My man's blackballed. This is more than a thing.
Nah, definitely. Well, I wanted to jump into it. I didn't want to waste too much of your time. First of all, I wanted to ask one thing, too. Why so many people be hating on you in the media, man? What's up? What's this, all this beef? All these fans is like, why you got Ryan on there? I'm like, yo, he's a respectable reporter. Like, he's doing his thing. And he was in the game, and he's outside the game. So he know both ends.
I'm going to be honest. This is what was really tough from my standpoint. And if I could have done some things differently, this is what I would have changed.
Okay.
When it comes to ESPN and a show like First Take, they're going to market a minute to 3 minutes of a segment. I've done 2 hours of a show 5 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
You know how much content you get within 2 hours of a show.
Definitely.
We're going to hit every perspective, every angle.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm going to tell you that LeBron, in my mind, in my opinion, is the best player of all time, I'm going to list 1,000 reasons. I'm a history major of why I believe so. If I say that Russell Westbrook could have competed and arguably beat that Warriors team when they were playing at their best, they beat them 3 of the last 4 times in the regular season. Mm-hmm. They're more athletic as a whole. And the only questions with Russell has never been his talent. It's always been his decision-making because they don't have anybody to guard him. And to me, in my mind, that was a team that could have competed.
Definitely.
People read the headline, but they watch those minute 30, and they go and they jump out.
And they jump on you.
I'm not afraid to express my opinions, but I think the one thing I could have done better, and I didn't really realize how big a situation was, is hit an IG live. Put up my personal message.
Definitely.
See how you talk. They don't, like, I'm a family man. I work in the communities. I help. I will coach AAU basketball. Like, I got 4 kids. Like, I'm a tangible human being as my daughter literally runs in the room right now.
Like, I'm that. Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And people want basketball players to keep it real. And I was just honest with people. So that's what I think why people got to it and they didn't see the other shade of me. They just saw 30 seconds of me screaming. Now, if I – no, Bobby, don't play with this. You just want to grab the lotion. But, like, if you just saw 30 seconds of you at your – I don't want to say at your worst, but in a heated debate, like
– Yeah.
In a debate, if I'm talking about Michael Jordan, LeBron James, I'm not giving Michael credit at that time. I want to prove why LeBron is better.
Yeah,
so I got you. Like, why are you so strongly opinionated? I'm in a debate.
Yeah, that's the show. You're there to state your facts and your opinions at the same time. You know what I'm saying? That's up for everybody else to decide if they rocking with you or not, you know?
And a lot of people feel like LeBron is the greatest a basketball player of all time.
Yeah,
There's a lot of people that feel that. I'm not the sole fan. LeBron and Rich Paul,
I got you.
Who think LeBron is the greatest basketball player of all time.
These are
common opinions.
Yeah.
It was a lot of people thought James Harden was the MVP of the NBA last year. Okay?
Yeah.
But they may not have spoke about it. I talked to several players who went out and said that what he does versus what Giannis does, it's a real thing. And then when James Harden dropped the bomb and said, when James Harden dropped the ball and said, all Giannis does is dunk. If I was 7-1 and dunk, that'd be a whole different story. But they want to crucify me for saying it. You know what I'm saying?
When I
said Ben Simmons can't shoot 2 years ago on SportsCenter, it blew up Ryan Hollins this and that. Like, now everybody's talking about Ben Simmons can't shoot. If he doesn't expand his game out past 15 feet, it's going to be a problem.
Nah, definitely. Well, I'm glad you was able to speak on that because, you know, my thing is, it's like, you got a job to do. You're being professional with your job. You have an opinion, but at the same time, they need to understand that there's clips that are shown for clickbait, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
that's how you market the show.
Exactly.
Like, when we do
a
show, they're going to pull the hottest.
Exactly.
Like, if Russell Westbrook breaks Big O's record, you write your article, you report. What was it like to break the record? You're not talking about him diving on the floor in the third quarter.
You're talking
about the record, you know?
Yep, exactly. You're good. Well, real quick, what's your thoughts on the NBA coming back? Obviously, that happened. That's breaking news. So what's your thoughts on it? And did you want to see them come back? And do you like the scheduling that they got?
Man, I think one of the beautiful things about this situation is that Adam Silver, he's the GOAT at taking lemons and making lemonade.
Definitely.
And before this, the NBA had already been exploring play-in tournaments, a 16-team format, you know, getting rid of the East and West, just going to his top 16 team, 16-seed league. So, you know, they've already taken precaution to see what it was, and they're willing to adjust. And as a player in the league versus Major League Baseball, there's not as big of a shock when it comes to change. People aren't losing their minds. Players aren't losing their minds. And I get it at first. It was kind of cool. Like, all right, we on vacation. You know, 82-game season is a grind. And then it got to a point where it just wasn't cool.
Yeah.
And you want to see basketball back again playing with fans. Stop it, girl.
Definitely. I definitely appreciate that. Because I feel like the same as you. Obviously, you want to see basketball come back. But for me, I kind of was like, let's be safe than sorry. You know what I'm saying? And I didn't mind starting on Christmas Day if they had to do that or whatever without them playing. But I also appreciate the greatness that LeBron was putting on. And I think he deserves, you know what I'm saying? He deserves his moment. So I'm not even mad. But I definitely and my Thunder, you know what I'm saying? Just covering that team, they're doing what nobody expected them to do. You know what I'm saying?
There were talks, bro, before the season. The consensus was that Chris Paul was never going to wear an Oklahoma City jersey.
Yeah.
And he was going to move on.
Yeah.
No one expected Chris Paul, for one, to be as healthy as he is.
Man, he healthy,
And for two, to be playing basketball at that high of a level. It just makes you go back and raise the concerns that we all had when he went to Houston, that there was not enough time in the shot clock for me and James Harden to have basketball.
Yeah.
Because, you see, You're getting the best out of Chris right now, right?
Yeah.
When he's the guy.
Yeah. They moving that ball. That three-headed monster with him, Schroeder, and Shea, man, I'm telling you, I had them coming in because we had to do our little preseason stuff and everything. And I'll be the first to tell everybody, I had them like ninth or eighth seed coming in. I was like, they're just going to squeeze. But the way they played, man, night in and night out, just watching that team, man, I've seen the chemistry firsthand, and those guys hang out in the locker rooms, outside, at the gym. You know what I'm saying? They really bought into what Billy Donovan, and Billy Donovan too. He deserves a lot of credit too, because you know everybody was ready to write him off last year. You know what I'm saying? So the fact that team, he came back.
My only question with that team, bro, was health.
Of course,
I did play-by-play. Analyst work with the Clippers a year prior.
Yeah.
Danilo Gallinari is one of those guys, like, he's an A-minus star. Yeah. He's a B-plus, A-minus. I was never an all-star type of star. He can guard Giannis. He can guard KD. If you go and pull it up, Kevin Durant said Gallo was one of the toughest guys to guard him. I watched him guard Giannis one-on-one when they beat Milwaukee at the house.
Okay.
When Gallo is healthy and playing, he's right on par with anybody else in the league. That's and Shea, as everybody knows, he's one of the biggest emerging stars that we have.
Definitely.
We don't even need to talk about what Chris Paul is when he's healthy. So you're seeing it, but the matter was, is Gallo's back going to go out, or is Chris going to be able to play?
Yeah.
those questions have been answered, and it's a good mix. You want to say the blessing, as you brought up, you know, Schroeder and Shea. The blessing in disguise is that Chris got more time playing off the ball than he ever has in his entire career playing with James Harden.
Yeah.
So, in a sense, he saw the luxury, and Chris is such a perfectionist. I played with him
over
in Los Angeles that he doesn't want to relinquish power and throw the ball up court because he wants to make sure the team gets the best shot.
The best shot.
But now,
definitely,
he's developed a different trust and looking at Shea like, I need you, little bro.
Yeah.
I need you, Dennis. You know, like it's go time.
Yeah.
And there's enough of a blend and an age gap where they looking up to Chris Paul. There's going to be no lip.
There's no talking back.
And him and James were so close to where it was like, yo, like, you ain't playing defense either, dog. They were going back and forth.
I'm with you. I'm definitely with you on that. I respect that. But definitely. Well, let's get into Ryan a little bit. You know what I'm saying? We talking about everybody else. Let's jump into your upbringing in Cali. You're from Cali. So just talk about that and how your upbringing was, bro.
Man, raised by my mother and father. My dad, we nicknamed him Superman.
Okay.
Because he was one of the dudes, like, he would come home, play ball with me in the backyard.
Yeah.
Go to work overtime for 3 days straight, and then we'd see him. And like, my dad had the type of job where he had to work overtime to make the proper salary to keep the family and the lights on. So
he
was almost forced into having to do that. Then my dad held a spiritual, awareness in the house. I mean, he did it like, and then he would go and work out. Like, there weren't enough hours in the day. Like, I still think back, like, yo, like, how is he doing that?
That's crazy.
Basketball came late for me. And you know, it's funny. We talked about me not being able to tell my story. Like, people like jump. Why you say this, you say that. And I'm so like, I'm closer to the regular person than anybody else.
Yeah.
Like, I was cut from my basketball team in ninth grade. So, like, I was always the guy who was never supposed to make it, who made it.
The guy
who wasn't supposed to be there. So, they'd be like, oh, Holland's this. Like, bro, like, I'm more like you.
Yeah.
I'm more like you. I had to just grind to get on. Like, I wasn't the eighth grade All-American, the phenom with you know, boxes of Nikes in the deal. And the Tahoe Suburban out front that I'm driving. Yeah. Like. I really had to grind, bro.
I really
had to grind and get it. So
that's dope.
I always see myself as the everyday guy. Like, you know this, like, those us role players that played in the league, we have to work hard. We got to be personal. We have to have people skills. We have to do the everyday stuff. So for me, that's really been more of my journey that people haven't seen, because I seem so unrelatable, so entitled. And it's like, dude, even to get on First Take or to have a deal at ESPN, I was doing broadcasting while I was still playing. I was still putting together podcasts and stuff while playing and doing 4 hours of radio and begging to get on air and emailing stations and grind. Like, until you grind it out, you heard no 100 times, and then you finally get your yes and you capitalize on an opportunity.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to hear from you for someone to say that I should or shouldn't be on. Like, you ain't nobody done the grind work I done. It wasn't like, hey, buddy, you played in the NBA. Come on TV. Like, now I had to fine-tune my craft, because speaking for a NBA player that wasn't a coach is incredibly hard, because we've always been taught to shut our mouths and listen and don't give bulletin board material.
Yeah,
don't say anything. Be passive. You know, we a little bit cool, you know. So I had to learn those things. People don't understand that. They just look and they see entitlement. Like, maybe that's the millennial thing. Yeah. And forgive me if I came off like that, you know, if somebody took it like that.
Now, you was grinding to get it, you know? And that's super dope because...
Hey, buddy, I'm going to address you right now. And this is the last one I'm going to address. I will put you in the rim for one.
Who's this?
For two, get off of your egg account. Show your face, coward.
Who's this?
People like to pop in the little comment section.
Oh, somebody popped in?
Yeah, they like to pop in the comment section. Oh, they talk wild from the comments. Yeah, get off your egg account, coward.
Oh, we good. Okay?
But that's just a reality, man. I'm very competitive,
we good, dog. We good. Hey, there's going to be haters, but at the end of the day, look, if they ain't hating, you ain't giving them nothing. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, you're giving them something to talk about. So they got something to hate about.
I feel like I let it get overboard, though, because I felt like, all right, there are the haters. Then I feel like people were really looking at me. I'm looking at them like, dude, y'all know me.
Yeah.
Like, y'all know me. Or like, it was amazing to me. I'll put it like this. Keep this in context. Okay. I want this to come off as humble as it sounds.
All right.
People would tell me I have no business talking sports, but I played 10 years in the association, and you'll let someone who cannot dribble, walk, or chew bubble gum talk sports, and you think they should be talking basketball.
Yeah.
I feel like everybody's opinion is validated and has merit, right?
Yeah.
But it's funny that people will really try to drive that in for their own selfish need. Don't be brainwashed of that. Some of these Hall of Famers, you don't want to hear them talk because after 5 minutes, you're going to fall asleep. Definitely. So everybody has their own gifts, and if you can grind and work, it's all worthwhile. But Definitely. To say, oh, man, like, he shouldn't talk about, like, bro, skip, like, man, like,
you don't even let, these look, people. Look, don't even pay them no attention, man. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day,
sometimes you got to stay laser focused, bro.
You got to stay laser focused.
You have some players that will come out and say that. So you have some players. It's disappointing, but it's a brainwashing.
When the players say it, it's different. Because then at that point, you feel like that's a little disrespect because it's like we were both in those lines. You know what I'm saying? So I get that. But when you got those eggheads coming up in here, you know what I'm saying? They ain't nobody to waste. I ain't wasting no breath on eggheads. You feel me?
Facts.
That's just what it is.
I have fun with them sometimes, bro. I have fun with them sometimes.
I know. it fuels you, though, so I ain't mad at you. You know what I'm saying? I ain't mad at you. Who were some of your favorite players to watch growing up?
Man, bro, I've been blessed. Like, I feel like it was a dream. Like, this was my wall, bro, back as a kid.
Okay.
Kobe Bryant. This is like, you know, you get the Slam magazine bro, and with you cut
poster.
It out.
Yep, the poster.
Kevin Garnett. I had Antonio McDice banging on like Chris Mim.
Nice.
I had Tim Duncan, Shaq, Kobe, Garnett, Jordan. Who else? Like T-Mac, Vince when he was putting the elbow on the rim. That's why I wore 15. I told Vince it was crazy. Like, so.
Oh, that's dope.
When I got to the league, bro, like, I saw Kobe on the other side, like, I lost my mind. I'm like, bro, like, that's Kobe. Like, you don't understand. He was on my wall. When I played with Kevin Garnett, bro, do you know the battery that was in my back? The first time I had to guard Shaq, I'm like, bro, this is, like, I grew up with these dudes on my, like, that's so wild to me.
That's the real.
It was crazy with the NBA. A lot of those guys had, you know, 17, 18, 19, 20-year career. So you play it against your – what did Drake say? When your idols become your rivals. Rivals.
Like,
That was just crazy to me. But I would say that Dirk Nowitzki, I would say, like, playing with KG.
Yeah.
Bro, like, I was shaking my head every day.
You play with him in Boston?
I played with him in Boston. I was shaking my head every day, bro.
What year was you on the Celtics? Because I was covering the Celtics 2010 to 2014.
Might have been right around the time you left. Then we lost to the Heat in the Eastern Conference Finals. We lost to that Heat team.
When LeBron. I was there. LeBron. I was there. That's crazy.
You were there, bro.
I was
how
there.
You not remember you then, bro?
That's crazy.
Burn. What you talking about?
That's crazy. I was there. Yeah, I was there. Game six, because I already had all my credentials set for the NBA Finals and everything like that. I thought y'all was about to wax them. I'm like, word, my Celtics are going. We Gucci. We about to go and play the Thunder, and then all of a sudden, Game 6
and
LeBron. Yeah. That's so crazy because the thing was, though, I had limited access at that time. Okay. So that's probably why because that was the first year I started out, that year that was coming up. So it was basically one of those where it was like they'll give me 10 games here, then I miss 20. 10 games here, miss 20. You know what I'm saying? So then, but you got to start out like that. You know what I'm saying?
So, facts. I didn't even realize how hard it was hard for me to get a media credential this year. And I'm like, I should have a media credential just off the rip. No. What?
Oh, really?
What do you mean?
That's crazy.
Yeah. It's a different ass. You know,
put
so,
your blood, sweat, and tears into the league. That should be a given.
Maybe I ain't asked the right person, though. I try to, you know, it's funny. When my mindset, and I bring this up, like, it's funny you say that. When I come into the media game.
Yeah.
My mindset was I'm going to work like I'm an intern, bro.
You got to.
I will work for free. I'm a grind.
You got to.
Because I feel like if I could learn the media, how someone actually went to school for the media, if I can learn that part.
Yeah.
And then at the end of the day, I played 10 years in the association.
Yeah. Your resume is crazy.
I'm going to be fine.
Yeah, your resume is crazy.
I never felt like I could hang my head on just being a player, because I'm like, bro, it's 250, 300 some odd players.
Yeah.
And so many of them play. They're going to be taking my job. I can't just lean on being Ryan Hollins. That's only going to do so much. So I was like, I really have to learn this.
Yeah.
And that's what I think on a side note offends so many people sometimes, because I talk like I'm a broadcaster. I don't, if you ever hear me talk, I don't never go, man, when I played, I really don't like to just, they had to tell me to start throwing out stuff like that. Cause I was like, let me go pound for pound with him and what he does.
Yeah.
I knew if I can beat you at what you do, you can't see me.
Definitely. That's true. Yep. And then you got that experience of being in the lines. So you good. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So you got the best of both worlds, but you grinded for it. You know what I'm saying? That's the dope part about it, because, you know, for me, reporting kind of just fell in my lap. You know what I'm saying? I was in the right place at the right time and knew somebody that knew somebody. And then that's how it started out for me. But like I just said, they would give me 10 games here, 20 here. I would skip some. You know what I'm saying? So I had to work my way up to the All-Star games and USA Basketball and summer leagues and all that. It took a grind. You know what I'm saying? And I treat every day like it's the first day too. So I definitely do. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I'm always trying to continue to push the envelope. That's why I reached out to you, because I'm like, I'm always trying to look for that content that's going to continue to keep people coming back. You know, if you're not thinking outside the box or thinking about the next move, I look at it like chess. If I make a move, somebody else is going to try to do that same move, but I got to counter that move already. So I'm already ahead of the curve. You know what I'm saying? So that's how I look at it. But, yeah, don't worry about these lames that's coming in. I'm about to block these fools. They be talking reckless in here.
Come on, egg accounts. Come on, egg and private accounts.
Definitely.
That account, bro.
Yeah.
So the hive can be on that beehive.
Yeah, yeah.
So the Hollins hive is on that head.
Now
go ahead
see
and
you.
Unblock that account.
I see you.
Unprivate yourself.
Definitely. Did you get any sneakers growing up? Was you into sneakers? What were some of your favorites? And we need to know what's up.
Bro, do I need to walk upstairs to the closet, bro?
Go ahead, man. You can walk up there. Go ahead.
For one, patent leathers are the greatest on the white and black patent leathers, okay? That's just
Concord
a fact.
Concord
11s, bro. We're not even having a conversation after that.
Okay. You know what?
Listen.
I'm finding out about Ryan Hollins' stash right now. This is okay.
We're going to listen. This is exclusive, Brody. I'm going to do this just for you, dog.
I appreciate
that. We're going to go up and we're going to hit the closet, bro.
I appreciate that, bro.
And keep in mind, bro, this is a fraction of the closet. I had to give shoes away. Listen, you know what's funny? They're like, why don't you like Michael Jordan? What do you have against Michael Jordan? I love Michael.
Yeah.
I love Michael.
Yeah.
You don't understand that. I love Jordan.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm talking with my heart, LeBron can kiss my behind, okay? If I'm talking with my heart, LeBron can kiss my behind.
I got
it. If I'm going to talk about, like, game, how I really feel, I had to be honest with myself, I think LeBron's the greatest.
Okay. I ain't mad at you.
Hold on.
I'm ready. I'm ready. Man. Everybody in here
is ready.
You got
me turnt, bro.
Everybody in here is ready.
All right, bro. So this is just the little
start. Okay, I see some foam bodies, the dress shoes. I see.
Those are the dress shoes right there.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the dress shoes right there. Then we go up to all.
You got the fours. Yes, sir.
These are the solid ones. These are like, you don't wear these every day. You got to have a fit to throw these on with.
Yeah, of course.
These are my go-to travel solid, just the travel
hologram
shoes.
Foams. I'm with
hologram,
you.
They're go-tos. You're never going to tell how dirty they are.
That's
I
true.
I throw them on, I travel with them.
Yep.
These got to come with a fit. Can't throw these every day.
Need a fit for those. Okay, I see you.
These are the babies.
I see
you. These are the babies.
We're getting there. Ferraris.
These two, those got like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can't just wear red shoes. Like, you, like, remember back in the day, it was a white team with the stonewashed jeans?
Yeah.
Okay, a little low top, a little something casual.
Okay, you know what I'm saying? Something casual. With a
jogger.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh. Might have four, five, six, seven pairs of those. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, if I see them, I just buy them. Because you have to have those.
I see people in here saying what size you wear.
Listen, I wear your size. Homie, come see me.
Yeah. I see you. Okay, boom, boom, got boom. The thermal foams. Got some classic, ones in there.
Classics.
The these 20s are, when slept I, on. Listen, the 20s back in high school.
Back in high school, these were some of my favorite Jordans.
The 20s are slept on.
I know they
on.
Dusted. They, listen, trust me, they're brand new, but they just got dust in them. I need to clean them all. But, like, something about the strap. I don't think they look the greatest, but, like, you know the first time you get some Jordans? Because I couldn't afford Jordans. The first time you get some, they was, like, it was different. I think that's why I'm obsessed. You get obsessed with what you couldn't have.
Okay, yeah. Of course, yeah.
Great because boys, great we, boys.
You know, with our upbringing, you know what I'm saying? It's always, hey, you got four pairs. One for every season. That's it.
Listen, bro, on the low.
And I would get all these Air Force Ones.
Hey, these don't look like much. These don't look like much.
Those are elephant joints. Those are fire.
Elephant, but listen, the infrared is fire. Infrared is what hits in those. There was a whole Jordan line that came out with the infrared.
Yep.
Some of my favorites.
Okay. Yes,
I'm going to tell you a story about these. These were brand new.
Okay.
Steve Smith told me they were having runs.
Yeah.
I didn't have my shoes, and I hadn't played in a while.
Uh-huh.
And I went and wore these to hoop, bro. And I hadn't hooped. But I want to play so bad that I put these on. They were
ain't nothing wrong with that.
New, bro.
Ain't
they were brand new.
Ain't nothing wrong with that.
I still think about Smitty, man, because they were, you know, they were crispy. These are just solid boys.
You got the
boys.
Reflectives. I see you. The 3M. Mm-hmm. You got to call those taxi. You got to call those taxi 12s the Smitty 12s.
Yeah, the Smitty. These are some of my favorites, bro.
I love those.
Just with the blue jeans.
Yeah, people slept on those.
People slept on those. Those ended up being, you got to have an eye for them sometimes. Okay, there's another pair. I like to double up. If you're a real Jordan head, you buy two.
Yeah.
One to just wear around, and then one to hoop in. You know what I'm saying? Or your everyday pair, then you're back because you don't know when they're coming back out.
Yeah.
These got dusty up there. These are solid.
The dust means you're a true collector. That means you've been holding heat for a while.
Oh, bro, listen, you have no, you got no idea. Another pair, it's another pair. That's why I said you buy in two.
You
got to
double up. You got to double up. You're right.
Some of my favorites, bro.
Oh, the 10s.
You know what's crazy? Woo,
Chicago 10s. Yes, sir.
When I was in Boston, KG saw me walk in with him, and we got him. And I think KG Foot is a little smaller than me. He threw me some money. He was like, yo, youngin', go give me another pair of those. I had to get him some J's.
That's what's up. Okay, I see you.
Yeah.
You got the one?
Yes, sir. These are some of the classic boys up there. Listen, I never thought my Kobe's, I always played in Kobe. I never thought my Kobe's would have such meaning today, man.
Man.
Can't never let go of those now.
Yeah, RIP to Mamba, definitely. You got them snakeskin 11s there.
Oh, I can't show them all. We working our way around, bro.
Okay.
We working our way around. These, you can't wear these with every fit.
Nah, you can't.
Solid go-tos.
Definitely.
And if you see, man, I got the deal is all the way up there. So
that's what's up. Yeah, you really doing it. See, you really out here doing it.
These are real subtle. Like, if you saw me from a distance with these on, you wouldn't even know I had Jordans on. You get up close, like, are those twos?
Jordan twos, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Ryan Hollins got some heat, ladies and gentlemen. Just in case y'all were hating, y'all didn't know. Got the
Listen, bro.
I see you.
I want to say, did I make these? Are these customs or did I buy these?
No, I've never seen that colorway before, so I don't know.
I may have made these. I can't remember. Love them, though, but, like, it's an acquired. And you know the irony, bro?
What's up?
This is how I walk around all day long. So people don't know I have, like, people be stunned on me, like, what do you know about shoes? And I'm like, all right, youngin', let me show you. Let me show you how to do it.
Okay, weatherman.
You know what's funny? People are like, oh, man, he doesn't, like, rock Jordans. He don't wear a shoe because I just wear sandals.
Yeah.
And then when they see the J's pop out.
Oh, okay. Yes, sir.
Style a little go-to. Throw them on with the jeans.
I see you.
Or the little sweats.
I see you.
What did you think about these when they popped out? So
I like them. I love them.
Because you can take the deal off.
Yeah, you can take off the swoosh. Yeah, I love that. Yeah, I love that. I love
it. I like how you just looking at me like, bro, you're not going to catch me slipping. Nah, you're looking at me like, you're talking to a real sneaker.
Yeah. I'm not slipping. Those are the glow. Those are the glow fours. I'm here.
Some of my favorites, bro. Some of my favorites.
The crazy thing is, like, I would love to, honestly, like,
because. Where, are you from Baltimore?
I'm from Boston. So that's why. From Boston? That's how the whole.
Y'all, all y'all too.
Yeah. Those are fire too. Yes, sir. The Oreos.
Love these. The Oreos. Those are the solid boys.
The funny thing is, like, once I started the whole sneaker reporter thing, yep, I see you.
I want to say Ray Allen. I want to say Ray Allen gave me these.
That's what's up. That's love right there.
I might want to say Ray hooked me up with these. These are some of my favorites because they just look different. And I was never really in the KD shoes.
Oh, yeah, the KD6s. Yes, sir. Yeah, the KD6s. Those are fire.
I roll with these. I didn't necessarily like the hoop in them, but I roll with these.
Definitely.
Love these as a travel shoe.
Yes, sir. The Gamma 11s.
They're not going to really get dirty. And at the same time, I feel some type of way having on patent leathers.
I got you. The whole.
I can't have enough of these.
Yeah, there it is right there. That's it right there. That's it. That's those.
Bury me in my Concords, bro. Bury me in my Concords. If I pass away, just tell my wife, like, yo, put Concords on
it. I got you. The Columbia 11s, I see you.
You know what's crazy, man? I got to see. Hit me if you got someone who could fix this because they just naturally fade.
I got you. I got people that fix all the shoes and stuff.
Dunzo, I need to. You know, the nice thing with, like, it's like a collect. Like, you have to refurbish these shoes.
Yeah, 72 tens right there.
Some of my favorites because I could wear them every day.
Yeah.
And I'm not wearing them out. They're not these. Yeah. These are going to get dusty. These don't get as dusty when you rock them all the time.
Definitely. The crazy.
Really?
Oh, go ahead.
Really some of my favorites right here, bro.
Yeah, Lowe's. Yes, sir.
Because we went Lowe's. I could have bought, you know, you like, dang, I should have bought more, like.
Oh, yeah. I love those right there.
And they tell me, yeah, those are the solid.
That's premium leather, too.
Facts, bro, because they don't look like it.
Yeah. Yeah.
These don't wear as well. Like, I will hoop in these. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. They don't, like, I got to find the fit for them.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, snakeskin, I see you.
Always sticks out to me, bro.
Yeah.
It's funny, my dad, these were one of the first, my dad wasn't a Jordan man.
What's that, a size 18?
I said it's your size, man. That's what they got to know,
hey,
bro.
My size is 12 and a half. I ain't getting that far.
12 and a half, bro. Hey, my dad, these are one of the first Jordans he got, bro.
That's what's up.
And he had these. So when I see him, I always think of him.
Definitely.
Shout out Q Rich, man. Q Rich took care of me with those, man. That's my brother right there.
That's love right there.
Some of my favorites, dog.
Yes, sir. The Lowe's.
Should've got 20 pair of them.
That's crazy.
Should've got 20 pair of them. Can't go wrong.
Yep. Cool gray right here. Can't go wrong with the cool gray. I'm a Jordan 4 guy, so I'm all in. All in on that.
Like, what do you want to wear them with? We want to wear red today. We want to wear green. We want to wear black. Yeah. I'm wearing this with everything.
You can wear that with anything. That's the crazy thing. What? Yeah, the black metallics. Yeah, there you go. Now you coming with the heat.
This your language. Okay.
That's the language right there.
You the MJs for the culture. You for the culture. That's
for the culture,
You for the culture. You're not just rocking. I'm more so. Maybe as a hooper, like, hey, I remember the flu game or whatever. Like, you for the culture.
I'm for the culture, definitely. Those are fire. Those are the Westbrooks.
Mm-hmm. Swag on them, Russ. Yes. That's a little bro right there.
Yeah.
I love these.
Fresh print.
I love these.
Oh, you got some fire.
Now, I love these.
Yeah. You got some heat.
Bro, I love these. You know what I'm saying? You know, certain shoes, like, man, I love. Like, I have some. I got to find them. Where they at? They're all neon, bro. They're called the tennis ball ones. I love those. I wore them until they just.
Those
went
are
out.
My favorite right there. The playoffs.
Always.
Playoff 12 is my favorite. The crazy thing is with the whole sneaker reporter thing, and those are fire too. Those are the Taekwons.
Arguably my favorite shoe, bro.
That joint's crazy right there. That's fire. Now,
arguably my favorite shoe. Every time I wear these, somebody like even women be like, "Those are nice."
Yeah.
Like, people get – these are the ones, bro, like, if I could ever find those again, I'll pay good money for some more of those, bro.
Carolina Blues, can't go wrong with that.
Carolina Blue Kick.
Yep.
What did Jay say?
Shout out to
Solid,
Jay.
Bros. These are just the go-tos, bro. Put them on like an everyday shoe, bro.
Yes, sir. That whole – like, so the whole – those are fire, too. I remember those came out in 2013. The – the whole sneaker reporter thing came about. I was in the locker room with Stephen A. Smith and them. And, yep, the Bobcat joints. Those mean a lot to you. And, he's just showing out now. So, I was in the locker room with Stephen A. and them. And they was like, we see you wear sneakers while you're reporting this stuff every now and then. Why don't you just do it all the time? So then I was like, okay. They was like, yeah, you could be the sneaker reporter. Like, you could just be wearing sneakers and be reporting about the teams. So that's how that whole thing came about. Yep, Phoenix Suns 8s. But I would love to – the thing is now, there's so many reporters wearing sneakers now. I would really want to go at them. You feel me?
Like, they head.
I want to go sneaker for sneaker with some of these reporters.
And go at their head, bro.
You know what I'm saying? The Dons are crazy. Those are crazy.
You know what's wild about these?
What's up?
Arguably the most comfortable J I've ever worn. You got to kick it. It's something about this insole because it's leather on the bottom. You can wear these for all day. For those people on their feet all day, they're made different. They're made those different.
Yeah, that's that premium leather right there.
Yeah, they're made. Some of my favorites, bro. Some of my favorites. Talk to me, man.
Hey, the three is a classic shoe.
You know I'm from Pasadena, bro.
Hey, those are Bulls over Broadway. Yes, sir.
This man got me in the closet, bro. This is some MTV Cribs.
Hey, I don't care if this goes over or out. We just gonna jump back in. Yep, it's still tens. You can't go wrong with those, bro.
Go love those. You know what? From a distance, I was like, yo, these are trash.
Hell no.
And then I warmed it was like, nah.
Hell
no.
Them still tens is hitting.
These are different, bro. They don't look like much until you throw them on your feet.
He got games, bro.
Talk to me, bro.
He got games. That's the first Jordan 13 I ever fell in love with right there.
Really?
Yeah. I remember I saw Jesus Shuttlesworth, and I was like, I need those.
See, these are the ones I need refurbed. Okay. These are some of my favorites. These are the infrared bad boys.
Yeah.
But you get that white, the white turns
yellowish.
Mike is going to make you buy another pair. He know they got to drop again, like. But a couple of them, you know, you see that the gray, like, that just turns whether you wear them or not. Like.
Definitely.
Some of my favorites, these two.
Okay.
Some of my favorites.
I'll get you with my guy. I'll get you with my guy that does all mine.
Because, look, bro, these are to me, I'm kicking it with you at the park.
Yeah.
But I still have on 11s.
Facts.
But I still have on 11s.
Facts.
And these trunners.
Runners. Yeah.
Every day.
Yeah.
Every day. I'll rock these every day. They're like, why you keep wearing them dusty shoes? Like, these are the everyday ones.
Those are comfortable,
though. I'm going to wear.
Yeah, people were saying, did you get the Flint 13s?
Which ones are those? Which colors are those?
The one that just came out. My pair didn't come in yet, but it's the pair.
I got them. I don't. If they just came, I ain't get them.
But they came out back where you have some of this heat though.
I probably have them then. What do they look like?
Let me see. Hold on. Let me grab a picture real quick. It's the 13. White, gray, and blue.
White, gray, and blue 13.
I got you right quick. I'm about to Google.
Yo, bro. I love these. I just don't know what to wear them with.
Got you.
I just don't know what to
wear them with. You know, some of these Jordans recently are just, you know, they just, you can't. These joints right here.
I don't think I have those.
Okay. Yeah, those just came out this weekend.
I
don't think
I have those ones. Those are the only ones I ain't get because I was like, yo, what am I going to wear with them? I love them, though.
Yeah.
My boy.
Those are crazy.
You ever kiss the shoe, bro?
Yeah. The red.
You know what on the low?
What's up?
People sleep on these bad boys.
You're on your own on that one. Everything else is good. I just don't like that mix of the patent leather with the mesh. I ain't with it.
I know it doesn't look like much. But the gum bottoms are clean.
Okay.
But when you rock them, they don't look like nothing right now. But when you rock them, they pop. I swear, bro.
I'm going to hold you to it.
They pop off.
Wear them, make sure you tag me in it.
Facts.
All right. The elephant joints are tough. Those are fire.
Can't never. Any elephant print anything, bro. Like, you good.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You going with the threes. Yes, sir.
Talk to me, man.
Yeah. You out here. Hey. When I asked, I've never seen those before.
What'd you say, bro?
I've never seen those before. I don't even know what it's called. I know they're 11 bottom, but I've never seen that before. Ooh, you stumped me on that
hold
one.
On,
you stumped,
me on, reporter.
One. You stumped on. Me on that one.
Hold on. I got my guy.
You stumped me on that one. I know that's that ain't the futures. Those ain't the futures.
These two.
The DMPs. Yeah.
Man, let's have a conversation.
What is that, the infrared? You can't tell.
This is me and you have a conversation. He's infrared, bad boys.
Oh, that's infrared. Okay.
These infrared. Let's have a let's have a real conversation now.
Okay.
You know, it's crazy. I couldn't even really get LMAX in my size. I'm like, yo, they just not going to look right. These are basic boys. Like, just because I got some twos on. Like, I'm going to wear them.
You know what those are, right?
Hmm.
Those are Radio Raheems.
Really?
Yeah, from Do the Right Thing.
Oh, man, you learned some of these things. You learned.
Yeah, you got the Laney Fives over there. I see you.
Come
yep,
on, man.
I see you.
You know I love Mamba, bro. You know I love me some Kobe. I only play in Kobe.
Oh, man. There you go. Yep, the Jordan 10s. Those are crazy right there.
And then shout out my guy, PG. PG. But here's
PG's,
the real deal.
Oh, PG's family over here.
Here's the real deal. Here's the real deal. Okay, got a white and blue. Like the white and blue boys are over here.
Yep.
Got a stain on them. Get the brown kicker game. Kick it with me.
Yeah. Yep. The olives.
And listen, and you keep talking about these infrared boys. Are these? No, these aren't infrareds.
That's the Raptor Sevens.
These. Those are the regular boys. These ones, I gotta find a fit. I gotta find a fit to throw these on with. These bad boys right here. I gotta find a fit to throw these on with.
Ooh, okay, those are Shanghai joints. Them joints are exclusive.
Really?
Those
See, that's why I need
right
you,
here.
Dog, because I don't be knowing what's exclusive, what's not.
I'm trying to let you know right now. I think those are going for like a good $2,500 right now.
Snap-a-roo.
I ain't going to lie. I'm about to look it real quick, but hey. I know what I see. I know when I see some heat.
Let me see what else we got in here, man. Listen, we're not done, bro.
I hope not. Okay, yes, sir.
Yeah, we showed them OVOs. See, you said the blue ones. I didn't get the blue ones because I just didn't know. I don't think I knew what I would wear them with.
I got you. Oh yeah, you got the Olympics over there. Yeah, I just looked
these
at it.
These are some of my favorite. Any of these are some of my favorites because
the 14s.
These are one of my first, the 14s. I got the white and Carolina. Those were my first pair of actual Jordans.
Those are crazy.
Those were actually my first pair of actual Jordans. And then, look, here's the reality, though. We'll have to save this for another day.
Okay.
But I'm going to let you know. I'm going to just point to it. I'm going to just let you know.
Okay. Point to it.
I have three bins, like trash cans, three bins. I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you like this. I have three bins like this. Like this deal over here.
Okay.
Three bins like that. All J's to the top.
Yeah.
J's to the top. Three more bins of them, dog. Like, I had to get rid of certain J's. But, like, here's the deal. A lot of people don't wear my size. And certain ones, you just don't part ways with certain J's. Certain J's don't just walk out the closet. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They don't just walk out. Be like, I love you, dog, but you can't.
You can't
leave. What are these?
Those are the Dornbacher Jordan 10s right there.
Who is DP, bro?
That's the kid that made the shoe. So Dornbacher is a hospital in Oregon, in Portland, Oregon. And they have kids that are sick make a shoe every year. And he made the Jordan 10 that year. So you have the Jordan 10 of the Dornbacher. I have the Jordan 4 with me, and I have the Jordan 8 with me. So, yeah, those are fire right there, the Kobe, the Lowe's. Yeah, hey, your Shanghai joints, I just want you to know, that's what they're going for. Hold up.
It's backwards. Was that $2,500?
Hold up. Did it come up? I don't know if you can see it, but them Shanghai's
it's going, backwards.
Oh, it's going for like 14.
Oh, snap.
Yeah. Oh, and you ain't even know what they were.
I didn't even know they were. I thought they were garbage, bro. And then I still got some boxes.
That's crazy.
Got some boxes up here in the deal. So, bro. I'm a real. Like,
you out here. I see you.
Talking about sneakerhead, bro. You talking about Michael Jordan, bro. He doesn't make me laugh. I'm like, oh, he don't like Michael Jordan. Like, what?
That's what's
And
up,
I had
though.
To minimize. like just to fit it over here in this little section.
Yeah,
I had to minimize just to get them, just to get them to fit, bro.
That's crazy.
Just to get these bad boys to fit. I just start doing a podcast or whatever and just shooting here in the closet, huh?
You might as well, man.
The J's in the background.
You might as well. You could call it kicking it with Ryan Hollins.
Yeah, man. I'm a real life, like for real.
You got some heat.
You sneakerhead. Like I got approved. Listen, bro. I got 3 more bins of shoes.
Okay.
There's 3 more bins of them. Like like those two. Like 3 more bins of them.
You sneaker. Hey, you sneaker reporter approved over here.
Facts, bro. Hey, that's all that matters, facts, bro. Hey, coming from you, big dog. Coming from you, dog.
Hey, that's all that matters, man. You approved. You got the stamp over here.
Nah, man. Appreciate it, dog. Appreciate it, dog. Yes, sir. And this was, you know, it's funny I just say before, when I designed the closet, all I thought about was like, all right, how am I going to do my shoes? And I'm a tall guy. So I was like, all right, I need something that can go up.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I need something to go up.
You definitely
Otherwise,
did.
I'm not going to have anywhere. And I still don't have places to put my shoes. I will show you the wife's shoes. She got her nice little connection. She don't like Jordans though, but you know, she got her little shoe game.
She got a little something. I see you.
Yeah, a little shoe game together.
I see you. I definitely appreciate you for doing that too. You know what I'm saying? Because it's always up to the guest. You feel me? If somebody want to pull out some heat, I ain't going to say no. I'm never going to say no.
Yeah, man. I figure we both got a common interest for the J's. I got to, you know, we'll get to it. But I definitely need to, like, because listen, bro.
I got you. Say less. This. Say less, bro. When we get off of here, I got you. I'm gonna get you right.
Ooh, cause these are crispy.
We're gonna take care of the bottoms. Like, look. We're gonna take care of the bottoms. They're gonna be back to icy. Everything. We're gonna take care of you. You're good.
Yeah, bro.
You're good. Definitely will be good. How were the Cali Hoopers coming up for you? How was that? And do you feel like Cali Hoopers don't get enough credit? A lot of people always gravitate towards the DMV when it comes to Hoopers, but talk about the Cali Hoopers and coming up.
We always felt like there was an East Coast bias. We felt like when they went on TV, all they would talk about is Duke basketball. They ain't necessarily talk about UCLA or the West Coast and North Carolina. So we always had a chip on our shoulder when it came to just hearing about East Coast cats.
Yeah.
And like, you got to remember, though, it's different now. We grew up in an era where it was East Coast, West Coast beef.
Definitely.
Big and Pop.
Yeah,
like we were walking around throwing up West Side, like that was like a real, like it took a while before we stopped doing that. Like, this is really like West Side, like Pac had everybody on one. So
yeah,
in Cali, man, it was really a thing, man. But I feel like if you want to say the best Hoopers, I'm gonna say, LA, New York, and then maybe we'll go Chicago. You know, we'll say those three areas. You know what I'm saying? As far as like the hotbeds of hoop, you know, in my mind. We go down the list from back in the day to now, but LA is definitely like it's a bunch of cats from LA, you know.
I got you. Who's some of the LA cats that you came up with you as far as hooping that was really nice?
Man, you know, it was wild. The next generation was the one that really took off.
Okay, so but name a
it
couple.
Was like it was me, Marcus Williams, DeMar was actually a little younger than us.
Okay.
But he would always come to the runs. Russ and James, they were the young boys. But, you know, like we were like all the way, like the older heads out hoop with like Baron Davis, Paul Pierce.
Okay.
Like, all these cats were like all LA hoopers. Amir Johnson, he was a young boy, but he was in the scene. But we seen a lot of guys come through and hoop and get better. You know, Marcus Williams, who was at UConn. Marcus ran the LA scene.
Got
definitely
you.
Ran the LAC. LB, Bobby Brown, you know, a lot of these LA hoopers, man, were getting it in. But, you know, Baron Davis, in my mind, Baron was really known as to me, he owned our generation of hoop.
Okay.
He owned our generation of hoop. And then James and Russ just, they took it to another level.
Yeah,
they took it to another
definitely,
level with what they did.
Definitely, definitely. I can respect that. And I've covered both of them, and I've seen it. I've covered Pierce. I never was able to cover Baron Davis. That was one person that snuck out before I actually got my foot cemented in the ground with the media, but definitely somebody I definitely respect as well, you know. What made UCLA stand out for you? Was that, did you have any other offers, or was that the one and done? That's where I was going.
Originally, yeah, when you just dream about a school to go to, but I ended up signing with the University of Washington. You know, I was supposed to go to Washington because my coach left. I signed in St. Louis with Lorenzo Romar.
Okay.
And when he left, UCLA opened up, and then UCLA came on the board, and it was like, all right, UCLA not really fooling with you.
Yeah.
But it's still UCLA, and they're offering you a scholarship.
Yeah.
So when I went to UCLA, I knew I had to work from the bottom up. And I just went and grinded and worked and got my opportunities there. But I was just supposed to be a guy on campus. I wasn't really supposed to be playing like that. But I came in hungry, dog.
Yeah.
And pretty much made it to the league. But, I mean, I was on one. I was on one. I was, shoot, 6'11", you know, 205 pounds. I actually grew an inch in college.
Okay.
You know, that was interesting enough. So, I mean, my UCLA tour was it was a different journey than everybody else's.
That's what's up. Definitely, definitely. What was the toughest challenge, I guess, for you in college?
Toughest challenge for me in college is my coach got fired.
Okay.
So I had made excuses that I had a guy that didn't believe in me that was coaching me.
Yeah.
And when I finally stopped making excuses and just figured I had to do what I had to do to be successful, my career changed. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, when you're looking at your senior year, you're like, well, dang, I got to make it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not on anybody's draft board. They're not mentioning me. They're not talking about me. But I know I'm a pro. Like, I really had to sit back and analyze myself. I'm like, bro, I'm 7 feet tall and I have a 40-inch vertical.
Yeah.
If you don't make it to the league, there's something wrong. Yeah. I always felt like if I didn't make the league, there's something wrong. Like,
I better
pick it up. Like, when you're 7 feet with a 40-inch vertical, what's your excuse?
Yeah.
It would just be laziness and not applying myself. So that was my mindset when it came to making it to the league.
Okay, definitely. Who would be your UCLA top five? Well, starting five. It could be any position. It don't matter.
Kareem.
Uh-huh.
Reggie Miller.
Okay.
Barron. Marcus Johnson. Walt Hazard.
Okay.
I mean, literally, they're like legends. And, like, I'm leaving. We have 100 pros drafted.
I'm about to say, you leaving Kevin Love, Russ.
Russ and Kevin, like, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like UCLA, low key, has two starting fives.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Don McLean set the record for scoring at UCLA. Like,
yeah.
There was a bunch of bad boys, you know, over at UCLA.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of cats, man. It's a lot of cats, bro. For real.
Definitely are. So you leave UCLA senior year, you get drafted by the Bobcats. Just talk about that experience for draft night and, you know, what it meant to you.
Man, getting drafted, I went 50th. And I was so mad that I felt like all these people over me got drafted. So I was mad. I was upset. I didn't eat no food. They had, like, hors d'oeuvres there. I went trying to eat that. Like, I was upset and mad. But at the same time, I got a call from Michael Jordan on draft day. And I went from being upset to, like, knowing this is something special.
That's dope.
So, like, for me, that was, like, one of the coolest things ever, and I was, like, ready to go. Like, I literally went from mad I wasn't drafted, thought they were lying when they said my name.
Wow.
And then I'm on the phone 2 seconds later, like a dream with Michael Jordan and Bernie Bickerstaff and those guys. So
yeah, that's dope.
Getting drafted, that was a wild experience for me, but I went in with it. I didn't feel like, you know, some cats get drafted, like, oh, I'm on, I'm good, I'm the man, like, I felt like I had work to do. What's up, bro? What's up, Kid Plot? What's good, bro?
What's good? What's good?
I felt like I had work to do.
Yeah.
So I went in with the grind, like, all right, like, y'all got to see me mentality. And that got me 10 years in the league. It got me 10 years in the league, and I looked up, and I was like, shoot, one of the few people still left in 10 years later, which was wild.
Definitely, definitely. We got 20 seconds left here. I'm going to end this, but I'm going to come right back in. So you hop back in, and then everybody will hop back in, too.
All right,
bet. Hey, we back. For everybody that didn't know, Ryan, he went all out on his sneaker collection, man. So I definitely appreciate that. We're gonna jump back into it, and everybody can hop back in too. Shout out to everybody coming back in here. I appreciate y'all. Waiting for Ryan to get back in here. He went crazy with his collection. There you go, bro. There he is. Nah, we good. We still in here. We getting back live right now. There you go. So, you talked about your 10-year career. You talked about all the teams. Just talk about who were some of your favorite teammates on those teams, and you know, just talk about the funny ones. Who are some of those teammates that just stood out to you?
Jared Dudley, I actually played with him on 3 different teams.
Okay.
He's always been a funny teammate, but very intelligent, very smart.
Yeah.
I don't know why people say what they say about Jared. Like these clowns don't even know basketball. Like,
yeah.
Jared is an impact player and a difference maker. He's a glue guy. If you talk about the all-airport team with the eye test, he'll never pass the eye test. But talk about a guy who gets results on the court.
Yeah.
He is one of those guys. Darren Collison, that's like my little brother.
Okay. I
played with him in the league, played with him in college. That was really cool. Jamal Crawford, one of my favorite teammates ever. Cool, calm, and collected, bro. Always the same guy every single day. One of the most humble guys that I know.
Yeah.
Let me think who else, man. I mean, there's a couple of guys, man. Ramon Sessions, played with him 3 different times. He's always been a consistent guy in the locker room, consistent, good guy in Memphis. You know, bro, I had a locker room with Matt Barnes, Tony Allen, and Lance Stevenson, bro. Every day was something.
Yeah.
Every day was something. But, like, I mean, one of the funnest times I had in the league.
Because
you walk in the locker room and, like, they just be arguing over something, bro. Like, it was, like, calling each other ugly or something. Like, it was hilarious, bro. But, like, they'll really be going at it, bro. Like, it was hilarious, bro. And then, low-key, we were popping people. Yeah. It was me. Bro, it was me in Memphis, kid you not. The year that LeBron and them went to the chip, they had K-Love, all them. It was me, Tony Allen, Lance Stevenson, Matt Barnes, and Jermichael Green. And somebody else. We had 8 players, and we beat the Cleveland in Cleveland. Like that
That's
was
crazy,
just,
right,
like that was it was just that type of squad, bro. Like you never knew what you were getting. But like if we had like the squad and Jeff Green, if we had the squad together, we would have made like super noise. You know.
I got you. Yeah, y'all was short-handed, so it is what it is. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Nah, definitely. What would you say has been your biggest accomplishment in your career or even in your life? You know what I'm saying? What's been the biggest one for you?
I mean, in my life, obviously, my wife and my kids. That's what I was saying. Because everything I do, I mean, it's for them.
Definitely.
But I think, like, for myself, playing 10 years in the association because I was never supposed to be there.
Okay.
Like, everybody was like, yeah, he's not a pro. He won't make it. He'll be overseas. He's not, like, I was the guy who got cut in high school and then I played 10 years in the NBA. Like, that doesn't, like, name somebody else. Like, that doesn't
I can't
happen.
Name it. I can't name it.
I wasn't good. On the draft board my senior year and played 10 years in the league and made it to the, like, my career, I'm just resilient, bro. It's hard to explain. Like,
yeah,
I wasn't starting my senior year, and then at the end of the year, I lead my team to the national championship.
Yeah.
That doesn't
That's crazy.
Happen. Like,
yeah, that's crazy.
Like, I'm drafted 50th, and then I last 10 years later.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't happen.
Yeah.
I was cut from John Muir High School and ended up being the only ball player that played at UCLA. I mean, Jacques Vaughn went to Kansas. That was it. Me and Jacques Vaughn, let's talk about major D1 in my high school. Like, I didn't go to one of those big old schools. So, like, for me, I'd always find a way to shine through, which is crazy. I would find a way. Like, whenever I'm counted out, I will find a way. Like, I don't know how to explain it. Obviously, a lot of it is God. There's positive things on my side, but
yeah,
I just when it's time to buckle in, I know how to buckle in.
Definitely, I ain't mad at you, man. You grinded it out, and you put the work in. You put the work in. You know what I'm saying? When you put that work in, you see the results. You feel me?
Bro, when I finished playing basketball, and I thought I was gonna go into broadcast, and they had a job lined up for me.
Yeah,
they wouldn't even call me back, bro.
Wow.
They wouldn't even call me back. Like, people don't know the grind I had to go through. They just see, oh, he doing well. People wouldn't even call me back. People don't know what that grind is like. People talk about what you deserve and you don't. Like, I had to work so hard. Like you even brought up, like, bro, I was going to games. I had 10 games a year, so you had to get some fire footage. Games and stories. Like,
yeah.
Like people don't know what that's like.
They don't know that you grind.
Are now. Like, oh, what do you deserve to be with the team for behind the scenes or in the locker room? Like, because I put my work in. I put my time in.
Yep. No, I definitely respect that. Who would you say is the best trash talker you played against or even on your team? Who was the biggest trash talker?
Trash talk. Tony Allen was pretty good with trash talk.
Mm-hmm.
The best, though, way we're going to go that is Kevin Garnett, Kevin and Paul. Those two together, it was like we were going to war.
Yeah.
He'd be like, yo, Dwayne Wade is good, man. He's a dog. How we gonna guard him? And they're like, yo, bump him. Like, yeah. What? That's the way they're like, nah, bump him. We at his neck. Like, whoa.
Yeah.
I've never heard people like it was, man.
That's dope.
Like LeBron, they tried, man. That's why I have a different level of respect for LeBron because I watched KG and Paul and those guys go at that man's his well being. They tested him as a man, bro.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
And he came out a king. You feel me? So he
yeah, hey. That's why I'm like, nah, he's that dude. He's that dude, bro.
Yeah.
Anybody wants to, and Paul knows he's that dude because after we lost, Paul came in the locker room and was like, nah, LeBron is like, he legit. He's that dude.
Yeah. Yeah, and for Paul to say that, especially in his competitive nature, you know, and I was around him a lot too because I was in that locker room as well, and just him being that competitive and knowing how competitive KG was as well, like for him to say that, that takes a lot. You know what I'm saying?
That's why I said Paul knows he's top five. Paul is just trolling. Paul is competitive, bro. He's not gonna never stop being competitive.
Definitely,
that's who Paul is. Like he's not gonna stop being Paul Pierce.
Definitely,
y'all not gonna
I don't want him to change.
Yeah, y'all not going to troll him out of not being Paul Pierce. Like, y'all could kill that narrative.
Definitely. I would never want the truth to change, man. Never. I appreciate Paul for everything he's done for my city, too, man. Real talk. Because he came through a lot, too. You know what I'm saying? He had his moments. Facts. You know what I'm saying? So, his story need to be told as well. You know what I'm saying? Definitely does. So,
LA
what
legend.
Would you say? Huh?
LA legend, man.
Definitely. What would you say is the biggest difference or challenge, or what would you say is the biggest difference, I guess, between being on the court compared to being off the court, you know, talking about the game now?
I can control things when I played. You know, if I had a good or bad game, it's because I missed a shot or I missed a free throw, so you go back and you work at it.
Yeah.
When it comes to broadcasting, a lot of this is subjective. Like, what makes this guy a better analyst than you? Or what makes this guy better, that guy better? Like, tell me. I just killed the segment. Why am I not having my TV show or having certain things? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, so that's, I would say, the toughest part. I appreciate, you know, when the game is over, I don't have to take it with me now on this side. But when you played, you know, you were in it.
Yeah.
It was a thing. You didn't have the free time, so I still compete. I still want to be good. I still want to be better than the next person. I still watch other people's clips and see how I can improve. I still watch film. I take the same things into it. But
yeah,
I don't take the game with me the same way that I had to when I played.
Okay. I got you. That makes a lot of sense because even me just being a reporter and stuff, I'm not playing in the game. But I go back and I look at all my interviews on YouTube and stuff like that, and I critique myself because I feel like I'm my biggest competition. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like when I'm in the locker room, I'm different. My whole reasoning for, you know, being a sneaker reporter was to wear sneakers in the locker room and be able to create attention and be able to create relationships off that. Because if I walk in and be like, oh, snap, you got the Concord 11s on, I'm standing out from all the other reporters that are wearing a suit and tie combination that look like Joe Schmo. You know what I'm saying? So I wanted to stand out and be able to have my own lane. You know what I'm saying? So.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I would say this, like, for those who know me, I wear sandals every day. I'm not fashion, nothing like that. But, you know, one of the first times I went on First Take, I had a red velvet suit on.
Mm-hmm.
But guess what? They remember my name. So I looked at it like, man, if I had one shot at this bad boy, I'm swinging for the fences.
I'm swinging for the fences, yeah.
I was willing to be comfortable with being uncomfortable because I never wore suit and ties. Like, I'm a hooper. I wear sandals. I kick it every day. So to put on a suit and a jacket and all that, like, I was very uncomfortable. Jacoby, what's going on, bro?
Was good, Jacoby. Good
work today. Jacoby, man, good stuff on there with Snoop, man. That was a heck of an interview with Snoop, bro. Heck of an interview with Snoop, bro.
That's dope. That's definitely dope. Anytime you get on with Snoop, that's legendary.
Y'all gotta get your boy back on soon too. I got some hot fire, bro. We ready to go kill some stuff.
Yes, sir. Well, talk about how family life changed you definitely. Talk about that. Obviously, you're a father of four. How has that made you a better man and just, you know, internal growth?
I became uncool for the right reasons. You know, like, I used to worry about being cool.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I used to worry about being cool and showing out and being flashy and stunting and doing this and look what I got. Look, like, now I don't care about being cool. I care about my kids because I'm an example for them. Yeah. So if I'm going to tell them what matters and what doesn't matter, man, your whole mindset changes. Like, you know what I'm saying? So, like, like I wear shoes to be comfortable now. Like, I love my J's, but, like, I wear shoes to be comfortable because I've been there. I had J's. I've had a Ferrari before. I've had certain things. I'm like, I don't need to do that. I don't need to show everybody who I am anymore. I'm worried about my kids. Like, life slows down, and you become you know how important the little things are.
Yeah.
So I don't want to impress anybody. I'm not trying to get chicks. I love my wife. Like, yeah, I'm about her. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, why are you dressing like this and doing that? You do that to get women, or you could do that to show off. Like, I don't need to do that anymore. And when life slows down, you realize that's not what it's about. Everything for me pours into my kid. Like, before, let's say, for instance, I get a dollar in my wallet, right?
Yeah.
My mind, how am I going to spend this dollar? That's when I was younger. When I get a dollar in my wallet now, I know that. Like, my kids have the dollar. Yeah. That's my kids' money.
Definitely.
You know what I'm saying? If that makes sense. So that's my mindset. Right on time, bro. Right on
time. Well, we're going to make sure Dad get back to you. We got one last question for Dad. We're going to put him on the spot.
Look, bro. She come bust in the room right on time. Like, she heard you.
Right on time. What's your Mount Rushmore for the NBA? Who's your Mount Rushmore?
My Mount Rushmore for my NBA, Kareem, Kobe, Jordan, and Michael. And that's easy. I like it at four because I can argue Magic on and I can argue Magic off.
Okay.
Kareem, we can't question his scoring, his longevity, his unstoppable shot. LeBron James' impact on each and every team that he's played on.
Yeah.
9 NBA finals amidst different coaches, different teammates, different scenarios, and he's still playing at a high, high level.
Yeah.
Michael Jordan, sheerly dominant, 6 straight NBA finals. In a lot of people's mind, the greatest player to ever play the game of basketball. He never took a play or possessions off. And my man was almost competitive to a fault. He was $1 million competitive. Like, he can't turn it off. And Kobe Bryant was a spitting image. Imagine a guy who's psychotic about his work ethic, psychotic about his family, woke up at 5 a.m. to work out so that he could get back home to take his kids to school, then went and got it in. You know, it's funny. We laugh, or I don't want to say laugh, but you look at Michael's eyes and be like, man, Michael, your eyes look low. They don't look right, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Go and watch Kobe interviews. Kobe didn't sleep.
Yeah, the greats don't sleep.
He didn't watch Kobe's eyes. Go back and watch Kobe those last couple of years when he was playing. His eyes were so dark or so low because he did not sleep. He was that obsessive. He was in the gym at 5, 4 a.m. And listen, I'm up at 4 or 5 a.m., Brody.
Okay.
And the NBA games get over at 11. We don't get back.
Yeah, we don't get back.
If you travel, you get home at 1 a.m.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep. Definitely are. You're right about that. What's something you want to leave with people? What's something you want to leave with the people, and where can they find you? Obviously, you got a dope podcast. Just talk about where people can find you, follow you, and where they can support the podcast.
Go ahead and check out obviously Ryan Hollins on Instagram. They're Ryan Hollins on Twitter. Check out, man, the movement. Me and Brendan Haywood are doing Opinionated 7-Footers podcast, and one thing we do is we hit IG Lives and we try to post content from there right now that, well, obviously we don't have the NBA and everybody's here with COVID-19 at the house. But beyond that, we go and we have our NBA guest on, NBA guests, and we just, like, for real, watch it, because we just talk dope hoop stories. Like, as a real hooper, you know, behind the scenes, you know, what was it like guarding LeBron in game 6? You know, what did Michael Jordan say to you in a lot? Like we are pulling out those type of stories. We're getting some really, really cool content. If you had the opportunity to go and check it out. And for myself, man, I appreciate, you know, everyone just being in the journey with me, man.
Yes, sir.
Like, look, like, this job doesn't stop. Like, look, now I got to put her shoes on.
Yeah. Nah, definitely, man. And I appreciate you for taking the time out, man. Honestly, like, you know, if you need anything too, just let me know. You already know. You got my number.
You already know what I need. I need to refurbish them J's.
Oh, yeah. We're going to get that done. Refurbish them J's. Hey, we're going to get that taken care of. And
absolutely,
like
bro.
I said, if you need anything else, just holler at me. You know, facts. It's nothing.
Facts, man. Likewise, too, bro. Likewise, too, bro. Keep killing it. Keep working. Keep grinding. Stay creative, man, because I will say, you know, if there's any bit of advice, and I love you doing this already, especially on this side, if you don't do it for yourself, ain't nobody going to do it for you.
Facts.
So right. If you don't go grind, you don't go create content, you don't go write, no one's going to do it for you. Be comfortable being uncomfortable. Like, I had to do some writing before. I had to do podcasts. Radio was everything I've done as a player, this is very – people. Oh, he's always spoken well. No, I've been very uncomfortable. I couldn't formulate a sentence without using slang or saying or you know what I'm saying. Like, I had to work on a lot of that. And to a degree, now that I'm comfortable, I'll throw some of my slang back in the way I talk because it's me.
That's who you. Yeah, it's you.
It's me. But stay creative, Brody. Be yourself, man. Keep doing that. That's the biggest thing that I do. And that's my goal in just having longevity in the game, man. I don't take no for an answer. I watch these shows.
Yeah.
The same way as a kid when I watch Kevin Garnett or Kobe on the TV in the scene, I'm like, man, I'm going to play in the league. I need to be a part of that dance. When I watch ESPN, when I watch Undisputed, when I watch FS1 and these shows in the NBA, why that's not me? Like, why that's not me?
I got you.
And I work towards it. That's my mindset. I work towards it.
That's what's up, man. You out here doing it too, man. Hey, the way that you grinded, your story is definitely dope. You know, and I'm glad I was able to get you on this platform and be able to talk about it and shed some light. And we found out that you a crazy sneakerhead. So we found out a lot tonight. You know,
like
what I'm
saying? And people would know that. Like for real sneakerhead.
That's crazy.
Bro.
That's
and many
crazy.
More. The next time I'll pull out the archives, man.
Let's do it. Let's do a part two soon. Maybe you know. Right before the season start up, let's do it.
I think I do have those J's in there. The white and blues that you said, I think they are in there. I'm not 100%, but I think they're in there.
They probably
are. Yeah, they're in there somewhere, dog.
Definitely. Well, I appreciate you, bro. And like I said, keep in touch. And if you need anything, I got you.
All day, famo.
Yes, sir.
Peace.